Hi, my name is Kevin Thomas, W1DED. I'm really excited to bring this new guest aboard. His name is Braco Memic. He may correct my pronunciation. I've been struggling with it all morning. His call sign is E77DX. I'm sure many of you have heard him on the air, and many, many of you have him in the log. He's got a pretty storied background in ham radio and contesting specifically. Thanks for joining me.
Yeah, good evening, and nice to be here.
So let's begin, Braco, with your background. When did you get first licensed? And I'm really curious to know when in that journey you decided contesting was the thing for you.
Everything started back in 1987 in a local radio club in my hometown in Bosnia, in ex-Yugoslavia. And actually, the reason I went there, they had some working machine, some PC, which was more powerful than that one I had home. And that's what was the reason why I entered the club. And somehow I stuck into that ham radio course, make the exam, which I was failed on the first time, but that was actually the reason why I stuck into ham radio. And several months later, I get in touch with some, more or less local guys, and we were talking about some contesting, first local contesting, which we are so in ex-Yugoslav very popular, and my first, I think, contest which I did alone was 1989. It was WPX on 80 meter, and I was smashed from my friend, which is now E73Y Boris, and I think that was the start when I was thinking, this is something competitive, I want to do it.
So that was 1989 that you did WPX, but a lot has changed since then. I mean, you are in a lot of contests. You have built one of the biggest and best contest superstations in Europe. What was the switch that put you into that particular league?
Our club was pretty small, so I was always dreaming about having better antennas and building better antennas, having amplifiers, good radios. And I had some opportunities to visit some local clubs here in the region. And we built kind of contest place here in the city, which was on some high building with some wire antennas on low bands and so on. It was going like slowly. And then in 1992, there was actually 91 started already in Croatia, then in 1992 in Bosnia, the war. I left from Bosnia for Austria, spent some months doing nothing. Then I start after some time the studies, and I got there to the radio club on the technical university, and that was maybe a start of new era. There was a lots of equipment, some huge monobanders. I did have more opportunities to do contesting. Many things were just there, which nobody was using or very little in use. And over the years, I was seeking all the time for more and more. I was on many different QTHs in Austria, trying to build, a better contestation. Over the years, that was sometimes, I think 1999, when I was having a house in Croatia on the island of Krk that time, and with some friends, we started to do a IOTA contest from there. And I was thinking about to build the contest station there, like permanent, not always building everything up for the contest. But on the end, I came with equipment back to Austria. I joined the QTH of OE4RLC, Austrian guy. Then we built that OE4A. That was the beginning of 2004. But over the years, that get as well small. The property was not so big. And actually, by accident, I think in 2006, I did with a friend here, after many, many years, a contest from Bosnia. That was 160-meter contest. And I was, like, amazed about that. And one year later, we did it close on one lake close to my city, and that was the start, let's say, of E7DX. So on the beginning, I was thinking only on the low bands to do something, but over the years, let's say, OE4A was too small, and I make a decision to switch, and in 2008 I start to build this station. It was, now we have 16 years. It was a, let's say, long run, very long run about that, and yes.
I want to take you back a little bit just so I can understand.
Yeah, as you know.
I've only been back in ham radio for a couple of years, so this story doesn't come naturally to me. It sounds like before 2004, you were basically setting up contest stations almost portably. Is that what you were doing?
Well, in 90s, I was using that station in on the technical university. And after that, I was seeking for QTH everywhere. So, like, you know, downtown Vienna was not the best place. I knew it, you know, to make a very good contest effort. So we had some, let's say, some property which we could use close to Vienna, where I start to build a small station with few monobanders and so on. But we had some troubles to get some permissions to build up the big towers or whatsoever. So it was more or less portable. And then when I realized there will be no movement forward there, I back to university and did operate a few years more from university. And I did try, you know, there were several guys having places, and we tried contests from there. But it was not the place I wanted to, let's say, or I didn't get a real opportunity to do something where I'm feeling this is right. And then by accident, let's say, I was spending my holidays in Croatia, and I was playing with the radio, start to operate those IOTA contest. I met a couple locals guys there, and we did organize, I don't remember exactly, maybe 4 or 5 years in the row IOTA contests, and we ended on the one, let's say, not so bad QTH. We did from there, I think, one WPX and one CQ worldwide even. It was a, let's say, semi-portable thing. And I was thinking about to try to buy that property and to build up something serious. But on the end, I give up from different reasons. And when I decided to move all my equipment back, which I had, I didn't actually know what to do with all that stuff. So it was many antennas, many some portable towers, many you know, ham radio junk. And then one friend of mine told me, you know, there is a guy in south of Vienna. He has a QTH, and you can do something there. And I said, seriously? He said, yeah, why not? Yeah, just phone him. I already talked to him. So we called Rainer, and he said, yeah, no problem. Come here, do what you want. And I was like a little bit scared, but on the end, you know, we put all antennas there. And a few months later, we could. He had at that time only one tower, which was empty. So we arranged some antennas for 15 meters on that tower, put some additional small, let's say, 10-15 meter telescopic towers, and we did some contests, and that QTH was very interesting. So that was the OE4A, top hill location, By the way, you mentioned before we start the Randy. The Randy was on that QTH operating WRRL contest a few days later. So, and I stuck there for, I think, almost 8 years operating from that QTH, and which was actually not so bad, but limited in the space.
So I've got to say, your experience before OE4A is very unusual to me. Like, I've talked to a lot of contesters, and most people have either borrowed somebody's station the way it is, you know, somebody like N6 Win, or, well, I won't go through the examples, but there are a number of those situations, or they've committed to a station and they keep building it up over decades. But I haven't heard many people that have hauled their gear around and set up stations in various places, or taken over a station and built it out. So it seems like a lot of work and a huge commitment.
Yeah, it. How to say, you know, that time in Austria, there were few, let's say, contest groups. And as I said, my contest thing from Austria started on the Technical University. And there were not so many people interesting. So I was always the guy who did more and wanted more. And those guys, yeah, wanted to do a few hours on the weekend. And I said, you know, come on, guys. We can do better, we can do better, we can do that. And actually, I stuck most of the time alone. And it was, I need to admit, it was for me a long race. You know, when I came to Austria, I was like more or less being alone there. My parents stuck during the war, we lost almost everything. So I had for a years some broken 850 which I could repair, Kenwood 850, and after many years I could afford the FT1000 MP, which was the first transceiver I ever bought. And then I got some old RF tech. Actually, that's not old, it was never finished. That was some project on the university, HF amplifier, which was never finished, and I got that RF deck and couldn't finish it, and the amplifier was working, and that was my basically first equipment. And over the years, I did collect a lot of antennas, so everywhere where I hear that somebody is giving something away, I was there putting the antennas down, cleaning that, making some efforts. What I need to mention as well, there was I do remember on that, let's say, when we talk about the past, I think that was in 1994, I was with guys from Bavarian Contest Club. We were operating 41 Victor India Charlie for CQ Worldwide CW. And a few days later, I was there alone. For WPX CW as well, and that was, you need to understand, that station had only one small vertical, so if you want to operate, you needed to bring radio, amplifier, antennas, to go to the security with it, to go all permission, so that was horrible. And but it was my first touch with the BCC guys. And I can say I'm now, since many years, a member of Bavarian Contest Club. And with those people, especially, let's say, long friend of Manfred, the DJ5, and Mike Whiskey. And that was our first contest together. And maybe something else what I missed, but yeah, that's all that my activity in the beginning was connected with some, mostly I did it with the help of some friends, but mostly I did those single op efforts with on different places. So, and to be honest, in Austria there were other contest teams were closed, so it was very hard to get in. And yeah. So that was the story. During IOTA, I start to build my, let's say, those multi-op activities, my let's say, own teams and seeking for the people which were ready to do something together and such a crazy stuff. And yeah, but then when I get to OE4A, that was actually a nice project, and I was very pleased to have that time. In the meantime, there is another guy in Austria who showed up. That was in, let me think about it. That was in the late 90s, and that's Ivan OE1DIA, and he was. After some time, he started to seek as well for a contestation, and he finds something north of Vienna. That's OE3K. Somebody does remember. He stopped contesting, but he has still a huge station with several towers, which was built during 2000, maybe from 2005 or something like that. And I know there are now a lot of information, and I'm jumping from one place to another, but I'm trying to give some figure. And I did a lot of work together with Ivan and building that station as well. Did some contesting with him and as well alone from that place in Austria, and that was, let's say, kind of backup for me when I was not able to travel to Bosnia after 2008 or something like that.
So I want to go through some of the contest stations that you have operated from, and I don't recognize all these call signs, but first of all, anybody can see this on your QRZ page, so if anybody's curious, just go to Bratzov's QRZ page, but he's operated from D4C, CN3A, 403A, IO2X, 9 Alpha 1 Tango Tango, 9 Alpha 1 Papa. I mean, the list just goes on, and there's some amazing stations. I've got to suspect that with this experience you had operating at fantastic stations, as well as all the experience you had setting up stations, this really informed your most recent decision building your contest team E7DX. Tell me about that. Tell me when E7DX was formed as a contest team and what that was all about.
As I mentioned before, there was a group of people. We didn't know each other from before, most of us. I was belonging to younger generation of the contesters from ex-Yugoslavia, and I was not very well connected with all of them. So I did struggle, let's say, after the war to get in touch with all that guys, but somehow I get that opportunity, and I was spending my time, let's say, in my holidays in the Bosnia after the war as much I could. And of course I did get in the contact with the Hems. And after I did that particular 160 meter contest, I was thinking about, you know, to start something to do in my home QTH, and there were local guys from other city which is very close to where is the E7DX that's now E74EBL, particularly that was a Vlado E70T. We decided to give a try for a 160 meter contest here in the town or close by town, and it was like blast. I cannot explain that. It was we did 1 million points. We were even better than the guys from Belgrade, which were. Were master of the Balkans, let's say like that, on the 160 meters. And we used just a kind of a portable vertical and so on. And then I talked to let's say, I can tell he was my mentor during my young days, so when I was 13, 14, starting with a ham radio. That's E74AW now, and he told me, you know, why don't we try to use that old station, the tower, For the low bands, they don't use it anymore, the local radio station. And that's the place where I am now, that's the E7DX. And he said, I can arrange something. And he did arrange, and we got some permissions to enter the property, and during the years we make some contracts. The guys from YU4EBL, particularly E70 Tango, E76 Charlie, E70 Radio, they were coming many weekends all over the year, and we start to build this like antenna by antenna, piece by piece. And actually, I never expected it's gonna be like this. Then, when I decide to leave from OE4A, basically in the trailer, I took some equipment from Austria. I brought it here in maybe in 1 month. We put an additional tower, put more antennas, and we did some contesting from this place. Then I say, you know, it's working. Yeah, why don't we do more? And over the years, you know, 16 years since 2008, we have, I don't know, I think 9 towers here now in total, with many antennas. Of course, this was all the time my playing field, how to say, to test something and to share it with the community. Or later, I jump into ham radio business in 2014, and to use it, let's say, like to show to some customers or possible customers how does it works, and you know, maybe we can go this way, and this was working on my station, and so on and so on. So over all those years, let's say before I enter E7DX, I was like, how to say, I was collecting, I can, you know, I like to say junk, or like some friend of mine say, I was collecting assorted junk, and that was stored somewhere, and then I had this, let's say, huge place where I could start to build up piece by piece everything. And over the years, I can say I was sometimes lucky, sometimes less lucky, but over the years, you know, we did suffer here on this particular of this place back in 2014 with terrible floodings. So that was the time when I almost wanted to give up everything. So it was like 1 meter of water in the shack, more or less everything was destroyed, horrible. And yeah, but long story short, there is maybe, I don't know if I start to talk about this, it's going to take a little bit longer time.
So I'm trying to visualize E7DX, and I want your help with this. So there's an existing radio tower. When you first get involved, you put up, it sounds like, 8 or 9 more towers. Where exactly is it located? Is the property dedicated only to ham radio? Is there a house there or just a shack? Tell me more about that. Where is it, and what does it look like as I'm driving up?
Okay. Okay. So the E7DX is in the city called Prijedor, which is in the northwestern part of Bosnia. We are very close to the border to Croatia, and it's maybe 1.5 hours drive to capital of Croatia, to Zagreb. So we are in the northwestern part. It's flat terrain. We have some hills around which are not very high, but basically it's a valley. And this place, when we entered it, was used by a local radio in the years before 1992. And they give up the midways, and it stayed empty for a year. On this property as well, till let's say that was maybe 5 years ago or something like that, we shared the property. Actually, I was a guest because there was a local water company pumping the water out of the ground for the city. And 5 years ago, they decided to quit this place. So the whole place stay empty, and we could finally make fully agreement and with the local authority to use the whole property, which is about 29,000 square meters. So that was as well, let's say, another step where we could say, okay, there is the long time invest in this location is going to be how to save how to say saved for a future, and that was let's say like 5 years ago. Till that time, we had all the time contracts which were limited on the 5 years for. I said always we because. I considering this E7DX like a joint venture on many people. Even let's say everything behind this is maybe the I don't think so. The guy's gonna be angry about that, but it's 95% me. And but on the other way, without help of them, this would be not possible. So there is so much work. We did it done together so much hours. I'm not permanently as well here, so they are coming on regular basis, checking when something is broken, whatsoever, you know. So I'm trying to be here, let's say, more or less every 15 days, more or less, or in at least once per month, but sometimes. You know, if you have as well huge property as well, only the cutting the grass around, it's a terrible thing.
So that helps. I appreciate that description of what's going on outside. Now tell me what's going on inside. Are there multiple, well, there's got to be multiple stations. What are you using there for equipment inside?
You asked me that before, but I didn't answer. On the property, there was, when we entered, there was a small house which was... belonging to water company, which was removed when they left from here, and our shack is actually very small. It's one room. I'm now there, so I'm now in the whole shack. It's approximately 30 square meters, a building, no windows, only one door. It was a transmitting station before, and we did adapt it for our use. And there was only one tower, and over the years we built, let's say, those 8-9 towers, whatever it is. In the moment, we have here 6 operating positions or places. They are the station is optimized for single op and multi-single, which is our main category when we're doing the multi-op. We can do as well multi-two or multi-multi, but it's not our target. And using since 2 years, 3 years, something like that, I finally let's say we use now FTDX 101 MPs radios, and there are 5 of them here, and on the 6th place we have. That's like our 6th station. It's second inbound. It's FTDX 10. So if you, I can a little bit show you that maybe here. This is behind me. Our main, let's say, run station or SO2R setup. And if I turn around, there are another 2 station. Basically, each station is the same. So we have on each station same radio. We use microham equipment here for our controlling our switching system, which is probably one. I would say probably one of the complex switching system I ever saw everywhere. So anywhere, let's say like that. And I'm very proud about that because it's like my baby. We changed it over the years, I think, 5 times. And when I start to build that switching system, it took me, still not ready. There is always something to improve. But the first part, it took me over 1 year to get everything working like it should be.
So I want to underscore that point and just be clear. You've designed the station. This is a Braco design.
Yes, yes.
You're responsible for basically everything working.
Yes, yes. It's I do a lots of home brewing. It means on the beginning I was making everything from scratch, even making my own boxes, you know, cutting the parts whatsoever. Of course, now with the time, I for example, the whole switching is every box. I drill every hole, put every connector inside. We used boards from mostly from Mike from SJ2W, but everything I soldered. It was done by me, and all cables. It's outside. We have a heavy rain. Otherwise, I would go outside maybe to show you how does it look like. It's in one. It's outside of the shack, but we have in the moment here very very heavy rain. So everything is built from scratch. And I was over the years I was always thinking, what would be the best way for me or for us, what needs we have. And I all the time I said, I want to have full flexibility. It means every station needs to access any antenna what we have here. So even receiving antenna, and you can switch from one station to another without any problems. And that was all the time the main goal. And we control all the rotators from any operating place with the same piece of equipment from Microham and so on. And each station is accessible for remote. So there is a one particular station which does have more possibilities, can be used remote, but it's not everything is switchable remote, not yet. It will be, but all other 5 stations can be controlled anytime remotely. So usually the members of E7DX are logging here and operating the station outside of the contest for DXing or for small contests or whatsoever. They are logging here and we operating remotely. So frequently we are 2 of us operating same time, but sometimes it happened like 3 or 4 people logging in on the same time. So then we need to see who's gonna use what and who's gonna want to operate one band. But this is something when I'm sitting in Vienna and when I see this so many people getting together even remotely, and I'm so happy about it.
Is the remote operation more casual? Or are you also operating major contests remotely?
No, major contests. I'm always here. So I do on let's say weekly basis some other contests, small contests remotely. But when I want to compete, I'm always here. So the remote. Does give you many possibilities to I can do even SO2R, but it's not the same. It's actually not the same. And I said to myself, you know, when I'm here, I'm like isolated from the rest of the world. When I'm sitting in my let's say workshop and my office in Vienna, there is during the contest somebody is ringing. Wife, family, neighbors, somebody calls me. I usually pick up the phone to see what's going on. But when I'm here, I'm like cut it from the rest of the world. And from tomorrow afternoon, I will be not maybe watching a little bit of the phone live score or whatsoever, but I will be cut it off of the rest of the world till the contest end. The WAE is on the weekend.
Well, you don't even have a window, so you're definitely cut off from the world.
Exactly.
I'm really mindful of the time, and this interview is obviously just going to be a foundational conversation because there's so many more questions I want to ask you, and I'll definitely have you back to ask those. But before I let you go, I do want to touch upon, you mentioned you are in the ham radio business, and I didn't know that. What is your business?
It is, everything started, you know, through the hobby. Yeah. And I would like to take a few minutes just to try to explain how everything's happened. I was in the IT and computer hardware business, and during as well some transportation stuff, business like business, yeah, doesn't matter. And over the years, I just was, I would not say that it was okay. I was doing not bad at all, but I was not happy doing that stuff. So I was always seeking to do something actually I like more. And in 2014, one guy, actually I did have many requests before, like to help people, and I did it on the regular basis. Let's do their antenna, put that up, repair something, and so on and so on. Yeah. And in it was end of the 2013, the one guy in Austria asked me if I want to help him to build a station. And I said, you know, okay, I can give you some advices, but it's depending what you want to have. And I visited him at home, and on the end I told him, look, this is a large project. I can give you a hand, maybe 1-2 days or whatsoever, but I cannot do that like full time. It's just too much work. And he offered me, like, you know, I was actually asking you to do this everything, and I'm gonna pay you. And I was like, you know, wasn't sure, should I do this or should I not do this, and how's gonna be that, and so on and so on. And I decided to do that project. It was actually in December in Austria, very cold. But we could manage all the problems, and we do that. Actually, I did that project with without any problems, and that guy was so happy, and he recommended me to his friend. And somehow, 2014 was for me a very difficult year, because that was the year when I get divorced or start divorce period, and I decided as well that time to quit all other jobs. So I just stopped other companies doing anything, so beside one small part of transportation business, and which was running alone still. And I was as well in U.S. That was the WRTC, and I in Boston. I stay in United States as well. Sometimes after WRTC, and that was the year about the same year when we had that flooding here on E7DX. So the station was absolutely not in use from April till September or even October. So I wasn't here, and everything was destroyed. So the guys did save what they could save, and yeah. And in 2014, I get one by one some possibility to work on some stations, to build up the stations. That include as well, of course, some hardware sales. So it is not my primary business in the ham radio, but I do sell as well some equipment from different radios, amplifiers, whatsoever. But it's not the core business. The core business is actually repairing buildings, the stations, changing the antenna, whatever you need. So, and I did the work on in 2015, for example, on Delta 4 Charlie, when the Italian guys decided to replace all antennas there. So I was there for, I think, 15 days. So changing all antennas, I did work across the world. Of course, there is as well work in Austria, Italy, Germany, and so whatsoever. So this is basically what I'm doing now, and it's like let's say I'm now 50, yeah, and I'm don't seeking to go other in very deeply into business and make a big company of it. So that's what I'm doing. It's enough work. It's good paid, and I'm happy with it. And only how to say decision to grow up, really grow up, will be if my son want to join me in the company, and I gonna put more effort than I need to do now. So
So I'm tempted not
that's
to
the
ask
story
you any
behind.
more questions, but is your son a ham radio operator?
Not at all, not at all. I can show you later some pictures when they were young. I took the pictures with them with the tubes with the CW gears, and they were all the time in touch with the radio. But even my daughter or son, they just not interesting in the ham radio. Of course, another dimension is when we are talking about work in the business. So now when I seek some help, my son is tied to time going with me and helping me out.
Well, if it's any consolation, I talked to a lot of people that said that they weren't interested either when their dad was showing them, but then they met a friend or they walked by a house with a tower up, and all of a sudden they were very interested in learning ham radio and learning CW. So there's still hope. Braco, I really appreciate the
There's
time
still
you've
hope.
taken today, and I can assure you'll be back, because I have a lot more questions here for you. But again, I'm mindful of the time. We will get together again in the future. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you very much for the interview, and it was my pleasure. Have a nice evening.
I've been talking to Braco Memic. He's in Bosnia, E77DX. Listen for him at the next contest. Thanks again.